Hello, welcome to this session on sustainable human security. This is Dr. Marco Davanti. I'm the chair of the International Public Service and president of the World Engagement Institute. Those insights that are presented here are part of a graduate course of the International Public Service that focuses on the study of international relations and conflict management. And some of the insights are also fruit and elaborations of various colleagues with the World Engagement Institute that have been working particularly around some of the insights collected in the International Journal on Sustainable Human Security. So, to reflect about human security is probably almost needless, because we have too many reminders in the local and international news. Our security is still on the forefront of our concern, and also of situations like is happening in the news as we speak. Just a couple of days ago, the Boston attack during the marathon is one episode. Or even the recent incident in which the young diplomat Anne Smeridov lost her life, unfortunately, in Afghan bomb attack. This is a reminder that also this reality of insecurity is something that is happening continuously elsewhere. And if we follow international news, as most of us do, we see that those happening are a matter of news of every day. But also, the issue of human security is something that pertains to this reflection about institutional contribution to both prevent but also to diminish those side effects as well as policies that perhaps have victims, continuously victims of, in this case, of children due to the drone attacks or other type of negative consequences that undermines the inherent value of human life. This is not to judge that certain operations may or may not be the right choice. The issue here is that to recenter the overall reflection of national security into a more human security process. Other issues that do not pertain specifically to conflict per se, but situation of injustice or discriminations, and therefore violence, like the recent episodes of Malala in Pakistan with her attempt, and she became kind of an icon for right to education and against violence for young girls. And that's the episodes of the reminder of these rapes in India are also an aspect of the issues of lack of human security. So, if we are understanding that those many episodes and many issues of lack of human respect, human dignity, and therefore, safety, but what do we really mean by human security? How do we get there? I just want to point out that a person like Sergio Vieira de Mello, that unfortunately lost his own life, a very promising and very capable diplomat in the international field, particularly for conflict management and humanitarian affairs. One of the volume that here is the cover really attempts to reflect more on the issue of human security, but around the focus on human rights. Another important aspect to it. If you don't know about his life, certainly books like Chasing the Flames by Samantha Power might be helpful to understand more his iconic work and interesting results and lessons for the international community, including the Obama administration right now, that certainly have learned a lot from his own practices and strategies to engage in dialogue with other leaders, even those that United States might have more differences. So, briefly, we understand that the national and human security share certain elements, but they also differ in some aspect. While the traditional security or national security focus on states, the individual security is the objective of human security. And while the interstate war, nuclear proliferation, revolutions are the main focus and concern of national security, we see that human security include other elements, not just those, but other elements that pertains to disease, poverty, natural disaster, violence, landmine, and human rights abuses, among others. So, in general, the national security and the human security also have a different goals. While national security focuses on security, securing territory, economic and political interests of the nation, for human security, the concern is about protecting the well-being of individuals and community so that they can live free from fears, free from want, and free to live in dignity. Those are the three main elements of human security. We will talk more in a second. So while the actors in the national security are primarily military, in the human security is a multi-track effort with multiple stakeholders who are involved in this, including communities, including government, civil society, business, academic, religious, media, and other actors. And I and other colleagues, we believe that human security is really part of these important trends that pertains to the post 2015 agenda, focused on sustainable development, but also recollecting the many elements and important agenda for having the world as a better place. I want to show you a little bit of a video from General Chuck Tucker. He's a retired general of the Air Force, and he's one of those colleagues that have founded the World Engagement Institute with me, that have been working on this issue for quite a while as a lawyer himself, an expert on human rights, and particularly international humanitarian law, also the called war, law of war. His focus has been on promoting this agenda of human security. So I've asked him recently in an interview what he thinks about human security. So I'm going to show briefly his.
On the issue of human security, we have to be aware that there is a spectrum of violence that many people have to deal with. If, in fact, you have one has no environmental protections in their country, and they're dying because of pollution, degradation, physical degradation of their facilities, that's not a peaceful situation. That's a human security difficulty. If people are living in large mega cities with no sort of social safety net, that's a security situation that has to be dealt with in a very complex way. Gang violence, inter-ethnic violence are another step up in the human security stairwell that has to be addressed. So as we're talking about human security, we're not just talking about police and military, we're talking about the way societies deal with each other, the way people deal with each other, the mechanisms that they have to deal with each other. Those can be community organizations, civil society organizations, educational programs to help talk about issues before they arise in a violent manner, to deal with, to talk about differences of people but also the likenesses, to come up with mediation methodologies that help people deal with conflict. These are all institutions that have to be dealt with if we're going to have human security or to help improve the security for most people around the world. That's everything from environmental organizations, educational organizations, clearly police and military organizations. All those have to be addressed in a very complex way so that people have trust in their society, they feel vested in their society, and they feel vested in one another. They have mechanisms to deal with each other in a way that helps lead to more positive outcomes.
So we have heard these reflections of human security. And now we want to really go more in depth about these elements and see what do we mean. What is important is the 1994 Human Development Report. As you know, those are annual reports. They come out under the supervision of the International Human Rights, International in the United Nations Development Report for these indexes of development. And the 1994, really, after the Cold War, had this focus on human development, as it was intended to be really the new trend. Unfortunately, many academics have responded not so positively about this concept initially because they saw it as too vague, as too difficult to comprehend or to measure. But really, today, with the complexity of the issues that we are facing, you know, from world poverty to global insecurity and other elements, we need to utilize those comprehensive frameworks, those integrated frameworks for different issues and elements. So in a way, human security in its comprehension is a reminder of the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, from the physiological safety to love, belonging, esteem, and self-actualization. But the paradigm goes even beyond that. For instance, another example that recalls this integrated approach is what the Asian Development Bank is utilizing in its approach. So for instance, starting from a first level, which is about survival, and then the second level, which we call is security, you know, which is really about also development in a way, as well as enabling, which is also in relation to the third dimension of human security that has to do with dignity. So if we put these things together, this is something that a diagram that I have elaborated myself based on the consultation with other of my colleagues in the international field. And we look at that human security in this case includes the freedom from fear in terms of defense, which strives to achieve more peaceful situations and contexts and dimensions, as well as the freedom from want, which is about development and obviously the achievement of prosperity. Below these kind of situations, we have what we call the situation of survival, which is not yet at the level of human security or human dignity, because the human dignity is also about the realization of every human being with the freedom to live in dignity. That's something that has been added, particularly with various reports coming from Japan and others that focus on this third important element. So, what do we mean by human security? There are some kind of also definition, like the head of state and government has stressed that the right of all people to live in freedom and dignity, free from poverty and despair, recognize that there is this situation of vulnerability of people that needs to be sufficiently addressed by countries, but also in the international community at large, because sometimes the protection of countries themselves sometimes may be insufficient. So this is a diagram that is similar to those elaborations that focus on the interception of human security between the freedom from want and the fear and the freedom from indignity at three aspects on the promotion of peace, development, and human rights. This is very important because it's also in relation to protection and empowerment. Those two elements, protection and empowerment, are closely connected to the notion of right-based development. The three dimensions of human security have also something to do with this inseparable dimension of human rights, security, and development, which in the same way that we cannot understand sufficiently the concept of sustainability by simply separating or living in the separate tracks those element of society, economics, and the environment, but they need to be integrated the same way as for human security. The human rights process is integral also to this because you see from this diagram that we need to go beyond the situation of survival and achieve more thriving, you know, possibilities for human beings in both individuals and communities. In the history of development and human rights, we know that from the United Nations history from 1945, the human rights track has been kind of separated to the development track, and still is, particularly on the with the other track, the third track, which is the security track, is still not probably yet sufficiently integrated with that. But in 1997, we finally started to talk more about this right-based approach, this human right-based approach to development and cooperation. So the relationship between human rights and institutional responsibility, this is shown by this diagram. That's the, what the right-based approach of development is about. There is an element of empowerment and an element of accountability, the institutional responsibility and the individual and collective rights. It's about creating a system of accountability that, as well as empowerment for claiming their rights and meeting their obligations. So the notion of sustainability, if we is applied to the notion of human security, has an interesting perspective, which is not just about sustainability in terms of green development, but really on the so-called fourth dimension, which is, in my understanding, also a central dimension to the equation of sustainability. So within the social, economic, and environmental, the institutional part is fundamental. Most people that might not work at the international level may, you know, narrowly interpret sustainability without this central element of institutionalization, unfortunately. But in, working in the international community would be like very inefficient not to think about the capacity development of those institutions that would permit to have a more sustainable development and sustainable situations for those communities and organizations in those areas. So if we talk about human security, we need to reflect on it as this integrated concept that affects many dimensions, you know, from political to economic, to community and personal, to health, environmental, food security, just to mention a few. There are obviously many more. And the dimensions that organizations like the World Engagement Institute in their work for sustainable human security identify these three areas in three sets of indicators. And the human survival element is about the personal security, community security, political security, national, public security. At the development level, there are emphasis on seeking processes and projects that emphasize economic security, but also integrated with food security, health security, education and environmental security. At the human dignity level, we focus on human rights, rule of law, justice system, democratic participation, and decent work. Of course, this is a very complex equation that no one organization could achieve it on its own, or no one institution can do that. That's why we talk about, in the last decade, of the importance of cooperation and partnerships, of sharing responsibility across sectors and across individual institutions that need to cooperate to achieve these large goals. So again, this is another example, another table that shows the various dimensions of security, from economic to food to health, environmental, personal, community, and political. Those are the kind of threats that we see in the human security aspect. And an example of it it's, that we should remind is the famine, you know, a few years ago that we saw in regards of the south of Somalia. That threat was not just due to the famine provoked by drought, even though that was one aspect, but mostly because of the interception of other elements, including the political insecurity and military insecurity due to the activity of you know, rebellious group and terrorist group like Al-Shabaab, that certainly had you know, this purpose of isolating international, I mean, community from international aid, and therefore not allowing people to get those aid. This is obviously in connection with the fact that without a proper structure of governance, a proper institution that also maintains and regulates a functional state, that would create even a more difficult situations for having effective humanitarian aid assistance, you know, and particularly exploring the root causes of these issues, particularly in the area of development. I think now we're seeing finally a re-engagement in that part of the world, particularly in the Horn of Africa and Somalia, with a new constitution, a new government, a new president that hopefully would resolve into a new trend. But certainly there are many stumbling blocks, and unless we focus on a more comprehensive agenda like this one, the human security, I'm afraid that the journey will be difficult to be achieved. Numerous resources are available both online and in publications, but the United Nations Trust Fund for Human Security is one of those organizations that has been on the forefront to give insights and collect numerous elements for understanding this important issue. The COF Forum for Human Security is also another important element that is been focusing on healing, memory, just governance, living sustainably, inclusive economics, and intercultural dialogue, among other themes. Mary Calder, which is also a senior lecturer at the London School of Economics and also written one of my favorite books on human security, states some of the principles for human security that has to do with the primacy of human rights, the legitimate political authority, the importance of multilateralism, a bottom-up approach, and a regional focus. Those are important principles for the achievement of the human security approaches. Key priorities that she states in her book are about combining humanitarian development assistance, which is the trend that we see more and more evident, particularly in major international aid organizations, as well as emergency relief organizations that have more awareness of the importance of transitioning aid and humanitarian assistance with development assistance. The creation of legitimate empowerment and self-sustaining livelihood. The institution building, again, see the institutional part, including the rule of law, which sometimes some organization might not think this is important, which is not, again, the rule of law about norms, but really about the construction of a new culture of respect and accountability in countries and regions. The attention to the importance of infrastructure and public works, the education and social services, and also the generation of tax revenue. This is important because you cannot achieve self-reliance and a more sustainable situation for human security unless there is a system that allowed those country and government to provide those important social services that are required for the maintenance of a life of dignity, but also a life based on security and more prosperity. In another connected or subsection of this element, human security, which is often visible in numerous programs or requests for proposal with various international development agencies, is a part of this security sector reform. The United Nations refers to security sector reform as the process of assessment, review, and implementation, as well as monitoring and evaluation, led by national authorities that has as its goal the enhancement of effective and accountable security for the state and its peoples, without discrimination and with full respect of human rights and the rule of law. This diagram, which I'm borrowing from Chuck Tucker, during his work with the International Human Rights Law Institute at DePaul, and now with the International Development Law Organization, has shared this diagram, I think a couple of years ago. I've seen it during a conference of the United Nations peacekeeping operations, in describing what are the perspective of stability and reconstruction from the United States government. And what is interesting here is that beside the escalation from, you know, prevent conflict prevention to the second phase of conflict mitigation and termination, or the third possible phase of conflict recovery, you see that the military presence, you know, which is somehow obviously higher in the height of the conflict, but you also see the civilian presence that somehow it's probably becoming more and more relevant. And civilian, I mean also private organization, but also civil society organizations that are more active within that. And that's why organization like the World Engagement Institute, you know, has been created and on the forefront of intersecting these various elements, including NGO, international organizations, military and police, but also academic institutions that have this important element and responsibility to build new cultures of peace. I put here some resources for you that I invite you to look at them. We have, there is an extensive bibliography in the World Engagement Institute website, and there are numerous both books as well as an annotated bibliography that you might find useful. Also, in the Human Security, the Sustainable Human Security Learning Forum, you will find various annotated bibliography elaborated by some of my students that might be helpful to you in various areas in connection with human security. So now that you have learned a little bit about what human security is about, we hope that this challenge of sustainable, building sustainable and institutional human security will become part of your own business, part of your own responsibility, and hopefully also part of your call to have the world a better place. Thank you.